Hey everybody, I'm Natasha Kirchuk, and thanks for joining us for ILTV's weekly program, One-on-One with Alan Dershowitz. We want to give you, our viewers, a chance to have your questions answered by Professor Dershowitz, one of America's greatest legal minds. He's a leading expert on criminal and constitutional law, civil liberties, and the Arab-Israeli conflict. Hi, Professor Dershowitz.
Hi.
So great to see you again. All right, so before we start, I would like to introduce Major General Amos Yadlin, who is joining us here in the studio. Amos is a director of the Institute for National Security Studies, one of the world's leading think tanks, and he is also the former head of Israel's military intelligence. So let's begin. As we all know, the state visit of the year for Israel has come to an end. President Donald Trump made a whirlwind 28-hour visit to the country as part of his first trip outside of the United States. So in both of your minds, what was the biggest news that came out of this trip? Professor, would you like to begin?
Well, I think the very fact that he came there on his first trip, that he said that he will never allow Iran to develop nuclear weapons. I've now urged him to follow that up with a congressional resolution saying that Congress adopts as the policy of the United States that Iran will never be able to develop nuclear weapons, quoting their own statement in the preface to the deal, in which they say Iran reaffirms that it will never under any circumstances seek or acquire to develop nuclear weapons, and the United States will hold them to it, and Congress should authorize the president to take whatever action is necessary to prevent Iran from ever, ever developing a nuclear arsenal.
The visit was absolutely a success visit. We saw a president that his heart and his mind is with Israel, the Israeli cause, the Israeli narrative. And this is a real important and unique phenomenon. The words and the speeches was amazing, amazing. Could have been given by Herzl or Ben-Gurion. But the real issue is what is done after the big speeches. Professor Dershowitz spoke about American legislation. I'm speaking since the summer of 2015 on a bilateral agreement between the US and Israel, how to cope with the future consequences of the deal. Because the deal was not totally a failure. In the short run, the deal stopped Iran, even rolled it back. The problem with the deal is the long run. The long run, the deal is giving Iran legitimacy for a full-scale nuclear program, zero distance from the bomb. This is not Bibi Netanyahu, not General Yadlin. It's President Obama admitting. So how Israel and America prepare for this day, we have to do here a strategic planning and a common plan how to deal with it, and the two sides should be committed to that.
I agree completely, 100%, that we have the same common goal. Saudi Arabia, the Emirates have the same common goal, and the United States has to first announce that its policy is not 8 years, 10 years, 12 years, but never, ever under any circumstances, as President Trump announced. And then I agree with General Yadlin, who I almost always agree with, because he is the most brilliant analytic mind when it comes to security in Israel and among the people of the world, that we have to do it in a bilateral way and come to agreement as to what the next steps are and how to make sure that Iran doesn't become another North Korea. Because if the world is worried about North Korea, multiply that 100-fold and you have Iran. Remember, North Korea is having difficulty developing delivery systems. Iran is allowed under this deal to proceed with delivery systems, including even intercontinental ballistic missiles that could reach the United States and Europe. Already they have delivery systems capable of reaching Israel. So the minute Iran is allowed to begin to develop nuclear weapons, they will march toward that result very, very quickly and much more effectively and efficiently than North Korea has.
Now, here's more of a theoretical question, but it has some very practical implications. Given all of the threats facing Israel, from Hezbollah to Hamas to Iran and even the United States, and the threat of North Korea and Iran, what gives one country the right to preemptively strike another nation? And I'm asking that, obviously, very close to the 50th anniversary of the 1967 Six-Day War in Israel, so it's also interesting to think about that.
Who do you want to answer that question?
Alan, you want to start?
Sure. The United Nations had a study commission not so long ago, headed by the former prime ministers of various countries, in which they asked to define what it means to wage aggressive war, which is in violation of the Charter of the United Nations. And they explicitly said that preemptive action, as distinguished from long-term preventive action, that preemptive action of the that Israel took in 1967 is completely lawful and completely within the Charter of the United States. If you have reason to believe that you're about to be attacked, you may attack first. You know, that goes back to the Bible when you talk about a rodef or somebody who is going to endanger your life. The harder question is whether there's authorization under the UN Charter, under international law, under rules of decency to take preventive action. If you have a short, middle term, longer term threat, such as a country developing nuclear weapons, which they say they will use against you, whether you can take action to do that. And the answer is morally, absolutely yes. As Dean Acheson, the former Secretary of State of the United States, once put it, no nation will allow its survival to depend on international law. They will do what it takes to protect themselves from catastrophe. If Britain had preventively attacked Nazi Germany in 1935, and caused the end of the Nazi regime, the world would have been a better place. And if it becomes necessary, only as a last resort, but if it becomes necessary for Israel to take preventive action to stop Iran from developing a nuclear arsenal, which they have said they would use against the state of Israel, that would be appropriate both under international law and under rules of morality.
Now, Amos, you have a personal story. I mean, you were very, very, very much involved and responsible for dropping the bombs in the Iraqi nuclear reactor. What is your response to this question?
Yeah, I'm taking this question not from a legal, I don't have the education that Professor Dersovich has, but I do have an experience, and I know a lot on strategic and national security consideration. And Prime Minister Begin, 37 years ago, basically created an unwritten doctrine, which is saying if a country that called for the destruction of Israel is about to acquire a nuclear weapon, we, the Jewish people, are not going to let again somebody annihilate us. So I was a young pilot in 1981, one out of eight that took away the nuclear reactor near Baghdad. And whenever I speak about this very exciting and dangerous Saudi, I'm saying the hero of this mission is not the pilot. It's the decision maker. In this case, the prime minister. Because he went against many advice of national security advisors and head of intelligence that told him that this will not stop the Iraqis, maybe for 2 years, 3 years. And we are now 36 years past the attack. According to the international media, another nuclear reactor was destroyed in the Syrian desert. By the way, in an area that now controlled by ISIS. Mm-hmm. And this was a North Korean nuclear reactor that was shipped to Syria, to Assad. I remind the audience that Assad is responsible to the killing of almost 500,000 people in his country. And it is not ISIS. ISIS may be killed 3 to 5%. The rest is Assad, Iran, Hezbollah, and Russia. And to avoid Assad to have nuclear weapon, and we saw that he has no hesitation to use chemical weapon, according to the international media, it was destroyed. And being in the decision-making group at that time, I think it was even more difficult than flying the F-16 in 1981.
Now, speaking of go ahead.
Okay, let me just add to that. Look, the pilots were the heroes, but Begin was, in fact, a hero. And he wrote, and I've quoted him, He wrote that one reason Israel has to take preventive steps to make sure that our enemies and Israel's enemies, the United States' enemies, don't have nuclear weapons is because Israel doesn't believe in tit-for-tat retaliation. As he said, a people that lost 6 million and 1 million children would never tolerate the incineration of 1 million children in Baghdad in retaliation for a nuclear attack. So because Israel rejects essentially the policy of wait until you're attacked and we'll attack and kill your people, it engages in preventive actions. And Amos's brave action in destroying and helping to destroy the Iraqi nuclear reactor resulted in the death, accidental death of only one person, a French technician who shouldn't have been there on a late Sunday afternoon. And the consequences were incredibly positive. The United States, of course, joined the international community in condemning Israel for it. There was a unanimous condemnation at the Security Council. And then a few years later, the United States Secretary of Defense wrote to the Israel congratulating them on their action and saying that they had helped save the world. Imagine if Iraq had nuclear weapons when it went into Kuwait, they'd still be there. And imagine if Syria had nuclear weapons. So taking preventive steps to save lives is both lawful and moral. And as long as it's done in a coherent, rational way, if Amos Yaslin were in charge, I would say it could be done all the time. Unfortunately, we don't always have strategic leaders with the brilliance, insights, and balance of General Yaslin. And so we always have to be careful about when preventive action is warranted.
Now let's speak a little bit about Syria, which both of you mentioned. There have been several Israeli officials that have considered bombing the Syrian crematorium in which many bodies of prisoners have apparently been burned. My question for both of you is that the right move for Israel to be making? And what type of obligation does Israel have to preventing what is taking place in the Syrian civil war right now?
I think the policy of the state of Israel is not to intervene. This is a lesson learned from 1982 when we tried to intervene in Lebanon on behalf of the Christians, but we found ourselves in 18 years of being in Lebanon that was not helpful. It makes a lot of sense. However, from a moral point of view, I think we should think about it again. Because 500,000 people, and many of them are women and children, a country that is destroyed by the Iranian Hezbollah, Assad, and Syria, and this is 200, 300 kilometers from us, we have a moral obligation to do something about it. It's not a Holocaust, nothing is compared to the Holocaust, but it's almost a genocide. Mm-hmm. And sometimes people are saying that there is a tension between moral obligations and strategic consideration. In this case, I think, and unfortunately I'm in the minority in Israel, that strategic consideration and moral consideration are basically overlap here, because we need Assad to go. And I wrote about it 6 years ago. I think Assad is not only Assad. Assad is Iran. He opened Iran, he opened Syria to Iran. He enabled Iran to transfer weapon to Hezbollah. And Iran is now stretching from Iran to Iraq to Syria to Lebanon because of Assad. And any future leader of Syria will not be a partner of Iran and Hezbollah. And this is Israel's strategic goal. So moral and strategy are going hand in hand.
I agree completely. On the crematoria, that's a symbolic target, obviously. It's not the crematoria that kills people, it's the crematoria that burns them after they're dead. If there were, God forbid, gas chambers, or any kind of killing mechanisms, wholesale killing mechanisms of the kind that existed in Auschwitz-Birkenau and Treblinka, I would be strongly in favor of bombing those killing areas. But bombing the crematoria is more of a symbolic gesture. I don't believe it would necessarily save lives. They would just dispose of the bodies in different ways. So I think that every decision Israel makes with this regard ought to be made entirely on strategic grounds. And if the moral considerations conflate with the strategic considerations, as General Yadlin says, that's even better. But I think when Syria is concerned, because it's a dangerous neighbor, strategic considerations must prevail.
And I want to say another point. The Syrians are using helicopters to drop barrel bombs. Barrel bombs is the opposite of precise weapon. So they drop it on markets, on civil neighborhood, on schools, even on hospitals. And for the last 3 years, I'm writing, I'm advocating. All you have to do is to send cruise missiles to destroy these helicopters. It's one night operation, no boots on the ground. 2 days before President Trump ordered the attack, and rightly so, not the crematorium, as Professor Dershowitz said, the killing machine should be killed. And I think President Trump, in this move, proved to the world that it's not zero or one. Full-scale war with boots on the ground or doing nothing. I think the art of strategy, the art of using military instrument and towards a political goal is to use it precisely, surgically, in the right place, in the right time.
Now, speaking of Trump, let's go back to the Trump visit here in Israel, which we somehow deviated from. Now that the Trump visit is over, what needs to happen on all sides to move forward with the peace process?
Progress toward peace between Israel and the Palestinians has enormous strategic advantages for Israel, not only its relations with the Palestinians, who don't really pose currently a strategic threat, but with the Saudis and the Emirates and the Sunni Arab world, which is terrified about the Shia arc that General Yadlin previously described. And particularly now with Saudi Arabia becoming a military superpower as a result of the $100 billion arms deal with the United States, the interests of Israel in creating a strategic alliance with Saudi Arabia against Iran, Syria, Hezbollah is more important than ever. So I would very much encourage the Israeli government to make political compromises, political sacrifices, in order to achieve a strategically advantageous benefit of moving toward peace and moving toward a deal with the Palestinians. Also, Donald Trump wants a deal. He wants to be the guy who brought about a deal. And it's in Israel's interest, if it's possible, within their security concerns, to allow that to happen. We certainly don't want to see Donald Trump turn into somebody who blames Israel for the failure of the peace process, because he's been persuaded, rightly or wrongly, that Abbas at this point is willing to sit down and negotiate.
Now, Amos, you've been a voice for Israel taking the initiative. Is this the time to do that?
No doubt, no doubt. President Trump brought two important messages. One, that the Arabs are willing to come to the table and to put some value on the table. In Harvard, a negotiation course, you learn that a zero-sum game is not a good idea. If somebody bring more value to the table, can be financial value, can be territorial value, ideological value, security value. So this is very important if indeed the Arabs are coming. Because until now, they sticked to the Arab Peace Initiative from 2002, which is unacceptable. It's an ultimatum. It is calling for Israel to go to 67 border, including the Golan. Very, very problematic language about the refugees. But if the Arabs are not showing Israel normalization and benefit from peace at the end of the process, but in the starting of the process or during the process, this is a real good news. He brought also from Bethlehem and from his meeting with President Abu Mazen the fact that the Palestinians want peace, which many, many people in Israel doubt. So the devil is in the details. And the details here are the parameters. What are the parameters of peace? Because most of the Israelis want two-state solution. Most of the Arabs, the Palestinians want two-state solution, but with different parameters. So the president have to sit with Abu Mazen and Netanyahu and see can they agree on the parameters. Anyway, I think that if Netanyahu will come to, and that's my recommendation to the president, and say, I want you to keep my back on Iran first, then security of Israel, no any compromise on security, and we have problems with the Palestinians about it. Then the blocks that will be part of Israel, and the Jerusalem, then I will show you the Israel I want, which give the Palestinians a lot more than they have today.
Mm-hmm. No, right. I agree with that. I recently had occasion to meet with President Abbas, and he certainly talked the talk of wanting peace. What he said was, why doesn't Israel begin the negotiations where former Prime Minister Olmert left off the negotiations? Now, that may not be acceptable to the current government, but once you start a negotiation, you're not bound by an end result that they, the other side, says is what they want to achieve. Once you begin a negotiation, there's going to be movement on both sides. So I think this is a very good time for negotiations with no preconditions to begin, and for Israel to try to make some agreement with the Emirates and with the Saudis, which would enable some legitimacy to be given to Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people, even if it's only symbolic in terms of flyovers and telephone lines and public business deals. This is the time for Israel to be saying yes, not for Israel to be saying no.
All right, everybody. Well, I want to ask something that is a little less serious and a little more fun to end our show, because unfortunately we are running out of time. You know, I always have wondered what it is like to work in intelligence and to have to hide much of your life from those that you love. So, Amos, can you tell us a little bit about what it was like as someone who worked in intelligence to deal with this issue? And, Alan, this is also something that you always face working with lawyer-client privileges, so I'm sure that you have some insight as to this issue as well.
As chief of intelligence, yes, you know a lot. And you are, this is your duty, this is your ethics, that you are not sharing it with those who are not authorized to be shared with. There is a very sensitive piece of intelligence, which we call even a black information, which you are not even sharing with anybody in the organization. And it's up to you to decide if you share it even with the prime minister, because there is issues of privacy, the issue of how it was collected. So head of intelligence organizations are people that the prime minister trusts them not to show him intelligence. And this is something I share with two prime ministers, two defense ministers, and two chiefs of staff, which used to be my bosses.
Alan?
Well, first of all, General Yadlin deserves such enormous amount of respect and kavod for what he has done for Israel and for the security of the world. You know, my situation is different. I don't have national security secrets, but I have people's secrets. People tell me deep, dark secrets that I'm not allowed to share with anyone, and I have to go to my grave with some of these secrets. And sometimes it causes me a problem because I'm criticized in public. And I have a perfect answer, but I can't give the answer because the answer would reveal lawyer-client privilege. So if you want to be a particularly criminal defense lawyer, you have to develop a very thick skin. You have to be prepared to be criticized unjustly and not be able to answer those criticisms, because confidentiality and secrecy have a higher level than your own personal integrity or reputation.
Unfortunately, that's all the time that we have for today. Thank you so much for your time, Professor Dershowitz. I also want to thank Major General Abbas Yadlin. If you would like Professor Dershowitz to answer your questions, go to ILTV.tv or our Facebook page and submit them. We'll see you again next week.